the giver of all gifts, ask me to give? The fountain from which every good thing flows, the life who spends himself that all might live, the root whence every bud and blossom grows, calls me, as if I knew no limitation, as if I focused all his hidden force to be creative with his new creation, to find my flow in him, my living source, to live as if I had no fear of losing, to spend as if I had no need to earn, to turn my cheek as if it felt no bruising, to lend as if I needed no return, as if my debts and sins were all forgiven, as if I too could body forth his heaven. As you've heard, I took as my title overall the whole thing, Imagining the Kingdom, and I'm going to make a defense of imagination, and I'm going to think about the imagination this time always in the light of Christ. From sort of 2014 through to 15, I set about what was my most recent poetry book called Parable and Paradox. As I worked on the sonnets, I realized that almost everything that Jesus says is an appeal to the imagination. I found myself using those phrases that the imagination loves to use. What if this? As if that? Suppose this? I suddenly realized that actually the analytic reason was simply not going to get what Jesus was saying. As I have argued in my book, Faith, Hope and Poetry, the Enlightenment ushered in a mistrust of imaginative and poetic vision. Some philosophers of the Enlightenment thought that the entire realm of objective truth was to be the exclusive terrain of reason. If it can't be weighed and measured, it's not really there. Coleridge says that there are really only two statements with which you can begin to think coherently about the world. And one of them is, it is, and the other is, I am. And he saw the entire problem with the kind of Enlightenment project is that it started with as though it is with a primal statement, and then thought that if it eventually studied the mechanics of things for long enough, he would somehow arise out of mere it isness at the statement, I am. And Coleridge is saying, that's never going to happen. All moral thinking is based on what Coleridge called the sacred distinction between a thing and a person. The real thing would be to start with the unmediated experience of I am-ness, but if I do that, it's always going to be a personal account. There's always going to be a sacral, personal, relational way. Christians themselves were divided. Some of them driven to a mere literalism, but others abandoning any real historical or factual core to the gospel. Samuel Taylor Coleridge grasped the problem. On the centrality of scripture, he wrote, quote, a hunger-bitten and idealist philosophy naturally produces a starveling and comfortless religion. It is among the miseries of the present age that it recognizes no medium between literal and metaphorical. Faith is either to be buried in the dead letter or its name and honors usurped by a counterfeit product. It's extraordinary, writing that in the early 19th century. Coleridge has this wonderful image. He talks about how the horned fly, when it's going to metamorphose into the fly that it will become, he says, the horned fly leaves room in its involucrum for antennae yet to come. That is to say, this little thing which doesn't yet have the antennae intuitively knows that it needs to make a shape to protect them. And Coleridge goes on to say that's what the imaginative arts are for, that they hold open for us a kind of shape into which the rest of us will grow. The reality of what Jesus discloses, both in his person and in his teaching and in the promise of his resurrection, all those things involve an imaginative shape making and holding, and a call for us to grow into those shapes. I began to see the whole teaching about the kingdom, all the parables of the kingdom, as encouraging us to see the shape of the new creation already, even as we begin to metamorphose in the old, and to begin to learn to live and grow into it. But the imagination gets there first.